Hey, brother, sister, brother. This is Brother Patrick again. And my last video, I came on strong as the Lord would lead me. Now, about Christmas and Easter. Should Christians celebrate Christian Easter? Now, this video I will do, people are asking me about communion. And I think the person who asked me is a Catholic. You know, and I mentioned it in the last video, Catholicism teaches that that you have to die in a state of grace. And you stay in that state of grace by going through what we call it communion. Then they do that every time they have a mass. And then there's the other ones, like getting married is one, becoming a priest is another. When you die, we call it the last rites. You know, for Catholics, the real name is extreme unction. When someone dies, that they believe, you know, that a priest has to, you know, forgive them of their sin, absolve them of their sins, and they would die in a state of grace and go into heaven. And then even like in the Philippines, it's 89% Catholic. They believe that, you know, when someone dies, I call them chanters. When someone dies, they pay people to come chant. When I say chant, they do much repeating and repeating. Like Jesus said, don't do like the pagans and keep, you know, with their repetitive prayers, you know. Don't be like that. In Sermon on the Mount in Matthew, Jesus said that. But they keep repeating and chanting and chanting, trying to chant these people out of purgatory into heaven, you know. So, in other words, if you got the money, no matter how evil of a person you are, you can have, you know, hundreds of people chanting for you, and you're going to, you know, somehow get into heaven. And so they do the same thing with the, you know, with the communion. And then, you know, that's the whole debate that happened all the way back, you know, when the Lord's voice started to, you know, be heard, and the dark ages was at an end, and the light began to dawn as the Bible was translated into English and then into German and all of that, and Martin Luther came out, and that's what they debated about, you know. What is the Catholicism, they call it transubstantiation, and that is saying that the bread and the wine actually literally becomes the body and blood of Christ. It's really eating his flesh and really drinking his blood. And the Catholics that I know, personally, they even call it, you know, in the States, they even call it vitamin J. Did you get your vitamin J? You know, they have mass every day if you want to go. And then, you know, and they think that through this work of, you know, they make it a work. They make it a ritual. And then through that, they're getting more and more grace. That's their teaching. That's their idea, that it literally becomes the body and blood of Christ. That's why a traditional Catholic won't hold, you know, they won't touch the bread and wine, only the priest, you know, because the priest is, you know, like the Jesus said, I hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. Now, Nicolaitan means victory over the laity, you know. Nicolaitans, victory over the laity. So it's, you know, having a priestly class. That's what it is. And then they're a higher level, and they're more holy, and they're more anointed. And, you know, just like what's in the Old Testament, it's like they can go to God on your behalf, and you can't go. They make themselves a mediator, the Catholic Church. And all the cults do the same thing. They try to make themselves a mediator. But the Bible says there's one mediator between God and man, and that's the man Jesus Christ. Now, communion, just like the Virgin Mary, you know, because of Catholicism has, you know, made a God out of Mary and ran it into the ground, lots of people even make fun of that. And we as Christians, of course, Mary said that all generations would call me blessed. So we should honor her and call her the Blessed Virgin. And then, you know, just like we should honor her, we shouldn't talk bad about anybody in the Bible like that, Moses or Noah, or whatever. We should be, you know, revere them and honor them as men and women of God and not make fun of them. That's God's servants, you know, and it's his biblical people there, you know, that's like Abraham and all those guys. So anyway, the communion has kind of been run into the ground and messed up because of this false doctrine and during the Dark Ages, still going on today in the Catholicism. So anyway, communion is something great, and it's great if we did it every day. But you don't have to. And the point for us, Jesus said, as often as you do this in remembrance of me. You know, and then Jesus said at the Last Supper, I won't do this anymore until I partake of it in the kingdom of my Father. So, you know, Jesus talking about the marriage supper of the Lamb. So when we take that at communion, it means to commune with Christ. You know, that we're going to sit at that marriage supper of the Lamb. We're going to commune with Christ. We're going to eat with him there in heaven. And that's what it's pointing to. And it's all in the future. And then now it's pointing to the fact that Jesus' body was broken for us. His blood was shed for us. You know, so, and then the Apostle Paul says there in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 that if you take it, you know, unworthily, you're heaping damnation on your head. So what does that mean? That means for all of you, let's see, what's the right word? For you people who are lukewarm and think that you can live like hell and go to heaven, also known as once saved, always saved, you know, crowd of, you know, backsliders, that's a good example. The good thing about communion for our daily life, if, or, you know, when we take communion, we're supposed to repent of our sins and be serious and be sober and, you know, imagine and, you know, meditate on. When we eat that bread, we should be meditating on the fact that Christ's body was broken for us. By his stripes, we were healed. And that's not only just physical, it's spiritual, mental, physical healing, our, you know, our salvation. Then his blood is shed that washes away our sins. So when we drink that, the fermented grapes, or grape juice, or what? The fruit of the vine. When we drink the fruit of the vine, some great product. I don't want to get into what you should drink. I mean, I try to be a teetotaler in the ministry. It says not be given to wine if you're a pastor, a preacher. So I don't drink. And I think if you really want to walk with the Lord, you shouldn't drink. Because, you know, not only does the Bible tell us, you know, no drunkard will enter the kingdom of heaven. It tells us not to be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. But, you know, it's hard to drink a little wine that's good for the stomach, you know. So it's hard to drink a little bit. You know, because most people drink for one purpose, that's to get drunk. And then when you get drunk, you become a different person, and you might do who knows what. So that's the danger of alcohol, just like gambling or what. You know, there's I've had lots of my relatives, they're all Baptists, and they all play the lottery, they all go gambling, and they justify it by telling me that, well, even if I've got a relative who's a Baptist pastor, and he told me, and preach that, well, there's nothing in the Bible against gambling, so, because his mama loves to gamble, there's nothing in the Bible against gambling, all that. But, you know, the result of gambling is the problem. You know, even my parents keep playing the lottery and all that, and then, you know, they've lost a lot of money on it, and they started playing there in North Carolina. Now they got these computer video gambling halls that's really illegal. I guess they're going to shut them down, but, you know, the Democrats are running things now, so I don't know if they will, but, you know, my parents have been losing lots of money in that place. And then lots of people have. So, see, that's the result. It's like being a drunk, you know. In the beer commercials, they don't show a 50-year-old guy with cirrhosis of the liver and lung cancer from smoking out there with the beautiful babes in bikinis on the Budweiser commercial. They, you know, the devil shows you the young guy, so strong and muscular, which you don't gain muscles from drinking beer. And then the beautiful, sexy babes, you know, you're going to get all these beautiful, sexy babes on the beach if you're drinking Budweiser. But the reality is when you drink beer later on, you know, you're going to have a big old beer gut and you're going to be, you know, that's the devil don't want you to see the final result. He just wants you to see this. The Bible says that sin has pleasure for a season. And that's true, you know, there is pleasure in sin, but it's only for a season. And then there's a day where we reap what we sow. And then I guarantee you that, you know, the cost is much higher than the benefit. Besides going to hell, even just reaping in your flesh, you know, you can get AIDS or cirrhosis of the liver, lung cancer from smoking, whatever, you know, that's not besides the fact we're talking about eternity. Even if you repent, it doesn't necessarily mean that the Lord would heal you of your lung cancer or your AIDS or whatever, you know, and there's lots of suffering and then consequences to our sin. Just like what happened to King David with his sin with Bathsheba, he suffered the consequences for that for the rest of his life. And it's, you know, even though God forgave him, he still, the sword never departed from his house for the rest of his life with Absalom and all that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, let me just draw it to a close for the people who ask me. Communion is great. It leads us to repentance and reflection on what Christ did for us. And it reminds us that we're going to eat it with him again in the heavenly realms. But it does not give us, you know, it's not our state of grace. We have a grace that is by faith and righteousness that is by faith in Jesus Christ, what he did for us.